Mazda RX-8 is a fantastic car, but there's one thing all rotary owners dread more than anything else. And that is why we have something called a compression test, to see how much compression our rotary engines still have so we know how much longer we need until we need a rebuild. But have you ever wondered why compression tests are done on hot engines instead of cold engines? Well, I did, and that's why I'm here today. I've recently picked up a rotary compression tester, and I'm going to be compression testing my Track Mazda RX-8. In addition to this, I'll be compression testing my engine while hot and cold, analyze the data, and then create a scaling factor so that if you're home with a Mazda RX-8 that doesn't start, you can do a meaningful compression test on it. But first, we have to understand why the Renesis engine compression changes with temperature. A simple relationship for thermal expansion is the change in length divided by the original length, which is equal to the coefficient of thermal expansion times the change in temperature. The rotor housings are aluminum with a coefficient of thermal expansion, alpha, of about 13 times 10 to the negative 6, 1 over Fahrenheit, in inches. The rotors are made of iron and have an alpha value of about 6.5 times 10 to the negative 6, 1 over Fahrenheit, also in inches. This means that the rotor housing is expanding roughly 2 times more than the rotor compared to its original size, per degree Fahrenheit increase. This is a lot when comparing a warm engine at around 180 degrees Fahrenheit of operation and a cold engine at about 70 degrees Fahrenheit. The apex seals are spring-loaded for this reason, to retain compression, but it can still cause a lower compression at hot temperatures. This is why hot start problems are a sign of low compression in RX-8s. So basically, the warmer the engine, the lower the compression. So on a cold engine, you're going to be reading higher values of compression. So let's get out in the garage with this thing and get some compression data. After letting the engine get warmed up, disconnect the eccentric shaft position sensor. Remove both leading spark plugs. Screw the sensor into the rear rotor housing, hand tight, then stomp on the gas and clutch with the car in neutral and crank it over. Now that we've got some data from the compression tester, it's time to see what these numbers really mean. Now that we have the results for this hot compression test, we can see how my RX-8 compression is. The first thing you will notice is three numbers. These are the three separate faces of the rotor, each creating compression once during a full cycle. My compression after normalization at 250 RPM was 198 and 94 PSI on my front rotor, and 104, 102, and 101 on my rear rotor, which is on the low side, and I should anticipate needing a rebuild in the future. Now what you guys have been waiting for. How much higher is the compression on a cold engine? Well, I just did my cold compression test, and I got the results right here. For the front rotor, for face 1 through 3, we have 104, 104, and 107 PSI, normalized at 250 RPM, and that was at a temperature of 59 degrees Fahrenheit. For the rear rotor, we have 110, 104, 104 PSI. Now we can analyze this data. We can assume an approximate linear relationship between temperature and compression based on our assumption that the materials in the engine will expand linearly with respect to temperature. If we average all of the compression numbers and temperatures, we get 99.83 PSI for the hot trials and 105.5 PSI for the cold trials. With this, we can create a linear scaling factor of negative 0.0629 PSI per degree Fahrenheit. So how do you use this number? Say you do a compression test on your cold engine, you measure the temperature to be 68 degrees Fahrenheit, and you get 110 PSI. Add the result to our scaling factor times 112 degrees Fahrenheit to get the normal operating temperature of 180 degrees Fahrenheit.
This new number of 103 PSI is your warmed up engine compression, which will be more accurate to your actual engine compression. This is still not perfect, and there are many factors that vary engine to engine, but should give you a more accurate result for your compression.
So I hope you guys enjoyed this video and got some useful information out of it. If you like this video, remember to leave a like and subscribe. And also, I'll have a link in the description to pick up this rotary compression tester and also to get these cool t-shirts that I just made. So if you'd like to get some t-shirts to support the channel, do that as well. Hope you guys enjoyed this video, and I'll see you in the next one.